Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duffy, and joining me in the studio today are Alan Temple.
Good day.
Graham Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
And on the line from Dublin, Ireland, is George Cran.
Top of the morning.
Well, it was top of the morning, George, until you delayed the start by going and making a cup of tea.
It's the slowest boiling kettle in history, I think, in this room.
It's 10 past 10 in Dublin. Surely you should be on the Guinness already.
It's all work here. There's none of that Guinness nonsense.
Well, I'm sure you had a pint of Guinness last night to toast Dundee's second 5-1 victory as they beat Bray Wanderers, having done the same to Brechin on Saturday. What a pre-season this is, George.
They're getting used to it, certainly.
Can we expect these kind of scores in the Premier League?
I think there'll be a distinct step up in quality, I think, when we get the real ball out. Brechin were decent, but Dundee obviously showed the class of it. And then Bray Wanderers are in the middle of their season. They've got a game on Friday. They've changed their team a bit. And I think even if their first team, Dundee would have been heavy, heavy favourites, and they kind of showed that. But Dundee were really good, actually. Two goals for Zak Rudden, superb, coming back. And Owen Beck, Liverpool loanee, looked very, very good.
I must admit, I was disappointed with that one when I saw Dundee sign Liverpool left back.
He's been...
How did he look?
He looked every inch a Liverpool player, I have to say. Sometimes you get these lone players coming up from big clubs down south, and you don't quite see the difference in quality, but you could see it last night. I mean, opposition, as we say, wasn't the strongest, but he was sharp. His movement was very good. He was very good going forward. We'd yet to see how he does up against some real threats going forward, but he can play. And
he has been
really
on load a couple of times before, hasn't he?
Yeah, and it didn't really work. He went to Portugal and basically immediately came back. I'm not sure what the story was there, if it just didn't work. And then he went out to Bolton, but didn't really force his way into the team. I think that was in League One down south. He played 9 games, I think. I think four of them were starts, maybe. But Liverpool took him back in January, and then he's been in their development team since. But you could see he's a player, and you could see why Jurgen Klopp in particular, and there's quotes from Trent Alexander-Arnold talking him up a couple of years ago when he joined them in their pre-season tour, and you could see why they gave him a 5-year contract, I have to say.
You do worry, Bear, sometimes with young loan players that they don't have first-team experience. Well, I mean, George says this lad's only had 9 games, but it is 9 games, and he's also been training with first team at Bolton. You hope that he'll be ready for the first team at Dundee.
I think that's the big thing. I mean, let's be honest, Tom. Liverpool don't sign bad football players. It just depends. Can he adapt to the Scottish environment? As George has said, he's been on loan a couple of times, you know, so... can he take to the Scottish game, and you know, there's sometimes rough and tumble nature that we've got in the Premiership, but he's certainly, by the sound of it, he's got off to a really positive start, and it has been a problem area for Dundee over the last few seasons. And as much as you know, I like Jordan Marshall, but he had his limitations.
Yes,
he also was affected by injury, which, in fairness to him, and there was a number of times when we actually saw Cammy Kerr having to slot in at left back. So hopefully this guy can come and stay fit and do a real good job. And, you know, it gives a real balance to the team if you've got that. He is obviously a naturally left-sided player. Was he playing at left back last night, George, or was it more in midfield? Do you think he can push forward or is he signed as a left back?
Bears wanting Trent Alexander-Arnold. Well, how many assists did he have, George?
He's, well, not as many as Fin Robertson, I have to say. No, he's very much in the mould of a Liverpool fullback. It's about going forward. When they signed him, I was having a look at his background. They signed him he was an attacking midfielder when they signed him.
But being in the mould of Liverpool, George, you just realise that other teams are actually going to attack Dundee.
Yeah, I immediately thought that. Can we get a defender, please?
That's the concern. Yeah. That's the concern when we get into league action, but he can certainly play going forward. His goal was superb. He didn't look like much was on, and he just burst past a couple of boys, passed it to, loaned it basically to Fin Robertson out on the left. He gave it back and he just smashed it in the corner. It was a really, really technically excellent goal. So early signs. It's still early.
Sounds like George watched a pre-season friendly. Maybe that was where I was going wrong.
What's the first half? Yeah.
And Zak Robinson back as well.
Yeah,
that could be a big signing, eh?
I think so. He was a brilliant signing last season twice. This is his third time he's come back. I spoke to him last night, and he's delighted to be back. He had other options, but he felt the kind of connection he had with Dundee and the people there, and the fans as well. He spoke about it was a big draw to come back, and obviously he'd done so well last season, and he'd be hoping to do the same this season. Obviously a step up, but it feels like you could see him developing through the season last season. It feels like he might just be ready for that step up. Just at the time when Dundee are stepping up, it might just be nice timing on that front. Overall, he played the first 45 minutes. He didn't do a huge amount. He scored two goals. It's not too bad.
It's his job. The other thing about that one, Alan, is there is a player who is an attractive loan signing because he had a lot of games with Dundee last season. So you would think Dundee have spent a wee bit of money because, I mean, the boy himself says there were other options.
Yeah, I think it's a statement of intent getting him back. I think it does help when the player wants to come back, that's for sure. You know, when you've got those options, leaning on familiarity is definitely something that appeals to loan players, because I've spoken to a million loan players and they all speak about, if they've been on loan to maybe three different clubs, they'll say you do that settling in process with every single club.
Yeah.
And it's difficult for young lads. So that fact that Zak will be coming into a dressing room that he knows and a stadium that he knows, training setup that he knows, that'll have been a huge draw. And that familiarity also goes with the supporters. You can see the reaction to his signing. It's given the whole place a lift. Not that it was particularly morose before. I mean, no. Positivity is kind of abounding
it
at the moment.
It doesn't take long for us Dundee fans to get down.
Yeah, well, for the moment, it's keeping that feel-good factor, as uncomfortable as you are with that, kind of going. And supporters are clearly delighted. And as George says, it seems like the player's delighted. And you would expect that consistency and that familiarity to bring the best out of Zak Robinson. And the fascinating thing will be to see what is the best of Zak Robinson. Is he a Premiership footballer? Because for all the excitement, we don't yet know if he's a Premiership footballer. And that will be, coming back to Dundee, I think, is the best opportunity for him to potentially show that, because he doesn't have all the other things that a young player has to worry about when he goes out on loan. It's, you know, he's coming back to a place he knows.
He does have that thing, Bear, that George mentioned there. Some games he made a big impact and he was a good target man, but other games, if you took away his goals, which nobody cared because he got goals, he didn't do much in the game. So it's always difficult to tell with those type of players, isn't it? Can they step up a level? You only know when they go.
Yeah, that's right. And I think his second loan spell, you know, after the turn of the year, he did make a difference to Dundee. George would agree with that. But he didn't score as many goals as we thought he might have got.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, just him being up there to hold that ball, add that extra bit of class up top, made the difference. It also helped Alec Jakubiak. We saw that, you know, he came into his own. And, you know, the two of them actually formed a decent partnership. Now, he's going to have to find another person up top, you know, if he's going to be playing every week, of course. We don't know that. But they'll have to try and form a partnership as well, whether it's with Zak Rudden or someone else. You know, I still think Dundee will need, you know, when you think that their front line, I still think Dundee will need an experienced striker. And I'm hoping that Tony Docherty's still got some money in the kitty to go and get someone. And I'm sure he's working on that just now. It may take a couple of weeks to get someone else in at this point in time. But it's all good. It's all good. As I was talking about, Zak Robinson is a developing player.
I was going to say that. We do have to remember he's only 20 in it.
Yeah, you
often
that.
See that. Some games he provided the goals. Other games he provided the link-up play.
Mm-hmm.
If he starts putting that all together, he's going to be a hell of a player, isn't he?
Yeah, he is. But he will find it tougher. You're going up a division, he's not going to find as much space. He's going to find the defenders bigger and tougher.
Less service as
but
well.
He is, you know, as a physical player, you can see that the way he's built. He's a powerful lad, you know. So hopefully his development can continue, and hopefully he can get the goals that'll keep Dundee in that division next season.
And George, as you mentioned earlier, Fin Robertson, 4 assists. I mean, I've noticed about the 2 games, Fin Robertson and Max Anderson featured heavily in both. And they're 2 players that we've mentioned in recent weeks didn't finish the season on a high, even though Dundee did. So it's good to see these guys, you know, trying to grasp their chance.
Yeah, well, I think, right, and remembering at the end of the season, I think both of them ended up missing out on even the matchday squad, I think, for the last couple of games. And they were fit, which obviously maybe tells you something about the squad that was there, but also told you that they had a bit of work to do to get themselves back in the team. But Finn was excellent last night. I was surprised to see him out on the left wing. Scott Tiffany picked up a wee knock in training, and they kept him out as a precaution. And so they decided to put Fin Robertson out there.
He must have been surprised to see himself out on the left wing having a match. I've never seen him playing there in his life. Where's that come from?
I'm not sure, but obviously it's worked. Tony Docherty obviously saw something in him and he showed. We all know he's got. I mean, Tony Docherty spoke about his game intelligence a lot after the game. He's a clever player, and he showed that in that game last night. He kept finding space behind their fullback and getting into really dangerous positions, and his delivery from those positions was excellent. We're talking about Zak Rudden scoring 2 goals. The 2 goals were pretty much tap-ins because Finn had put them on a plate. And he did the same with basically a 1-2 with Owen Beck. And then the 4th one was Zak Rudden actually looked pretty good in the second half as well, replacing Zak Rudden. And the assist came from the same place. He, even though he'd actually moved to the centre of the pitch at that point, he found himself on the byline on the left-hand side and cut it back for Rudden to finish. He just looked like his old self, if you know what I mean. It's we've maybe not seen it in a while, but we shouldn't forget, I was a bit surprised when I was writing up the piece and I checked his age and he's still only 20.
I was going to say old self at 20.
No, I know.
But he made his debut, was at 16, wasn't it?
Yeah, so he's been around a long time. Just on Zak Rudden, he's looked pretty sharp in the 2 games and scored obviously a couple of goals last night. But he was getting a bit of stick off Dundee fans actually at Bray, which was a bit of a surprise. I thought it was a bit untoward. I'm not sure. I don't know. He's maybe because he went out on loan last season, but I don't really see the reasoning behind giving him a bit of stick. It was maybe just late in the day after a day in Dublin, I'm not sure.
But I don't think he loaned himself, no, did he?
That seems a bit harsh. You were at Brecon, I was at Brecon, he didn't score at Brecon, but he did put in a hell of a shift, I've got to say. For the first sort of pre-season friendly, it looked to me like he was a boy who wants to be there and wants to impress the manager. And that's what he's going to have to do. I mean, that's what Dundee are going to need up top. They're going to need somebody who's going to cover the ground, you know, from the first whistle to the last, or how long they're on the park. And He showed that to me on Saturday. He definitely wanted to impress the manager, which is a good thing. But I don't know why he's getting stuck. I certainly don't remember anything on Saturday. I'm not sure where that's come from.
Took me by surprise, I have to say. But I don't think he was slow in giving some back when he stuck the second one in, I have to say.
it's quite entitled to.
He's actually got a decent scoring record for Dundee, if you look at the stats.
Aye.
You know, so... I think that's quite harsh. It might have something to do with the, you know, late in the day Dublin George factor about it. But
I think so.
Yeah, let's give the lad a chance.
That's really strange. Do you mean like he was getting jeered apropos of nothing, or was it just a few mumbles and grumbles after a missed chance, or was he actually being singled out? It seems really strange.
I'm not sure. I was just told from that side of the pitch that he was given some back.
Quite
to fans that have been giving him sticks. So.
I hate that. I hate, you know, one of my pet hates in football is when fans give, it's usually an opposition player, give them stick. And the boy scores and turns around and goes, ha, ha, ha. Yeah, does something. And the next thing, they're all running down to Stewart's going, oh, he shouted at me. What did you shout at him? I mean, that's part of the game.
Of course it is.
Yeah, obviously I don't see as much of Zak Rudden, particularly at Dundee, as you guys did. But he never struck me as a guy who was ever short of effort, if nothing else.
No, he was never accused of that. And Dundee, for a team that in the past, or a club in the past, I should say, that we've sometimes criticised their PR, they did a very good job of avoiding that this loan is with a view to a permanent move. There was no definitive thing about beyond the end of the loan. So it's not as if, I mean, we maybe suspected that St Johnson might try to sign him if he'd done well there. But he went to a struggling team. So nobody was going, it's all Zak Rudden's fault. St Johnson were having a difficult season. And nobody had ever said he was definitely going to sign in the summer.
Yeah, and to state the blatantly obvious, you're not going to get the best out of a young player who needs a wee confidence boost by getting on his back. So, you know, you don't want to give him the support that he may need if he's coming back and really, as Bear suggested, working hard to try and stake a claim.
Aye, and he's another one, a bit like his namesake, Zak Robinson. He does things that managers like and fans like and teammates like. It's about putting it all together and a bit of consistency, isn't it? So you can see why he's still there.
It's funny, I remember I was kind of freelancing vaguely on the Falkirk beat when he went there on loan as a really kind of raw young player from Rangers. I think he was 18 at the time. And you looked at him and go, he has uncommon attributes. You know, he has a real sort of gangly physicality to him that see if you put that together is really hard to defend against. But you see it with a lot of players of his build and stature, it's about putting it together, and that's sometimes a challenge and maybe doesn't happen until you get a bit more experience and play more football.
Exactly,
it doesn't happen overnight, and he is still a young man, and you can see why managers take punts, can't you? Because there's not many players that look like him. Physicality and in terms of his just the way he carries himself, you know, there's something there, and every coach will back themselves to get something out of him, I think.
It's funny, it's popped out of my mind there. I remember speaking to Jim Duffy about a young Nacho Novo, and he'd said, we're working on his finishing, because he could strike the ball better, he could be more aware in the box. And I said, oh, he doesn't link great either, does he? And Duff said, yeah, but you can't do it all in one season with a young player. If a young player has three things you want to work on, you won't work on all three of them, you know, intensely over the course of a season, because it can be too much for them. And it does. If you go, that's wrong, and that's wrong, it's going to affect their confidence as well. So he said, you're better to focus on one. He said, he started scoring a few goals. When he comes back for pre-season, then we'll work on the next thing. And it's a gradual process. But Rudden's another one that, He's got his flaws, but he's got a lot of things that you like about him too.
Yeah,
so
that's a manager's job as well. Yeah. To develop players. Novo went on and scored an absolute barrel of the goal for Dundee Rangers. So
made them a good bit of money too.
I would go back even further to a guy called Martin Boyle, who was at Dens, who came in raw from Montrose.
Dundee should have worked on him longer.
he got a lot of stick from the fans for some of the things he did at Dens. But look at the way he developed his career. I think Martin Boyle is a classic example of a guy who's improved, you know, every season. He takes something from the game, his hold up play, you know, his finishing, all improved. And you see where he got to in his career. And, you know, and he became one of the most, you know, dangerous forwards in Scottish football.
That swap deal for Alec Harris didn't age well, did it?
Bring that up.
I know. I knew you were going to mention that. That's a knife.
I'm sure we're going to.
Maybe not the heart, but the arm.
I'm sure we're going to talk about the team I covers transfer failings later on. So we'll get that one in, will we? Yeah.
We should mention the other end of the pitch. They've added another goalkeeper. We were wondering if it would be Trevor Carson, but he's Tony Docherty. And maybe it's a fan thing. I like it when managers pull out guys that, I don't know who's that, and you look them, you Google them and stuff like that. So sounds quite decent, but they've signed a goalkeeper in John McCracken, George.
Yeah, he's another player that's certainly needing experience. He's not played a huge amount of games. He's had a couple of loan spells himself.
Does that point to Legston's starting the season?
Well, interestingly, I asked Tony.
Well, George is frozen. Yeah, George isn't live from Dublin anymore.
I think if I'm Harry Sharp, I think I'm a bit disappointed in that. I thought Dundee would bring. Carson was obviously in the frame at some point, but maybe finances dictated it wasn't going to be him. But like you did with Beck, I mean, a briefing on Saturday, we had a trialist left back, and Jacob Jones, I think it was, George, who played. And very quickly, we moved on to Owen Beck, who has now signed a contract. So, you know, the manager's got more than one player they're looking at the time. But for me, the goalkeeper coming in, I'm disappointed if I'm Harry Sharp, because McCracken is quite young and hasn't got a lot of first-team experience. So where does that leave Harry Sharp? I think, you know, he's going to have to go on loan in search of first-team games.
I see that George is back with us. George, by the way, are you pressing pause so you can drink your Guinness without us seeing you?
Yeah, I was talking away there. I didn't think there was any problem. So
it was absolute gold myself in an empty room. Probably the best he's ever sounded.
That was your Oscar performance, George.
But no, I'd asked Tony Docherty last night about the goalie situation, how he saw it. And he said he likes to have three goalkeepers, which is interesting. But it's a fight for the jersey. He doesn't have a favourite. He doesn't have a number one at the moment. It's up to the three of them to battle it out. And see, he started last night with Adam Langston's in goal. John McCracken came on for the second half. Didn't have a huge amount of saves to make, but he looks very, very confident with his feet. Obviously, the modern way. So interested to see how he does it in maybe a different sort of opposition when he's a bit busier. But
if he plays on Saturday against Fleetwood Town, that would be more of a test for him and the rest of the team, won't it?
Yeah, definitely. And just on McCracken, he's trained with some pretty good goalkeepers at Norwich. Angus Gunn, the Scotland number one, is there. Is it John McGovern that used to be at Hamilton? Is it Northern Ireland?
Michael McGovern.
Goalkeeper.
Michael McGovern.
Used to McGovern. Be at United.
John McGovern used to lift the European Cup for Brian Clough. I don't think he switched position or is still playing, George.
I don't.
Sorry, John. It's usually me that gets names wrong.
It's John McCracken, Michael McGovern. I mixed them up. What were we talking about? Can't remember.
There's too many Macs in goal, that's what you say.
Yeah. Of Fleetwood, that's what
Fleetwood,
we're talking about.
Yeah. We were talking about Fleetwood. The only thing I can tell you about Fleetwood is the owner won't be there.
Oof, yeah. They might have bigger fish to fry than playing Dundee in a friendly.
He's wearing a different kind of uniform from now on. For those who don't know, he got 12 years in jail for fraud down in England earlier this week.
Oh no! I wasn't aware of that. So that'd be interesting.
I think that was your travelling day, George.
that'll certainly be a step up in quality. They're obviously behind Dundee in their pre-season schedule, so Dundee should be in better physical shape, I would think.
Which is another reason why I'm getting excited about Dundee's results. But they've played two part-time teams. Now they're playing a full-time team, but I've seen English Premiership teams come up here and play games and they were walking. We shouldn't get too carried away, even if Dundee can chalk up another good win on Saturday, because teams are at different places, aren't they?
I think certainly shouldn't get carried away with pre-season results, and I think we've probably fallen into that trap previously.
I did it about 29 times in 31 years.
But you'd much rather be winning games and scoring goals than not, and having worries ahead of the new season. You want your players being confident, and
said George, certainly the strikers, like a manager, eh?
Certainly your strikers, you want your strikers. The strikers just want to get going in the new season, get the first goal, even if that's in pre-season, and it really sets them up and gets them going. So more of that. The game's away down in Waterford, which is going to be a trek. I think there might be a few Dundee fans going as well.
I think it's a two-hour plus train journey, if I'm right, George.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Well, you just told me that before we came on here.
I wasn't going to give that away.
They've made the kickoff nice and early for you too, George. So
given that George is late for most things, who's betting on him missing his flight home on Saturday night?
It could be tight.
Well, we'll see you in a fortnight, George.
Can I just say, Tom, before we move on, just about Breaker on Saturday, a wee sidebar, and I was great being back to Breaker. You know, pitch was in fantastic condition, and the game worked out well for Dundee, and a good run out for Breaker as well. But I sat in the big stand behind the goal, and as soon as I went in, I realised I was sitting sort of 20 seats along from the Breaking Junior Supporters Club. They seem to have employed, or not employed, you know, they've got all these young lads together, 6 and 7 year olds, and they were giving it absolute loudly. They had the drum. I thought, I've made a mistake here straight away. And I was in early, and it was 10 to 3, and they were giving it big licks, and the teams came out, and they went even louder, you know. But unfortunately, somebody forgot to tell them there was a minute's silence before game. And the ground went silent, but these young lads were just kept giving it boom, boom, boom on the drums. One of the officials had to run quickly up the stairs and say, lads, stop, it's a minute's silence.
Poor lads, probably didn't.
You know, I've got to say, fair play to Breaker. I looked across during the course of the game and there was smiles on their faces, were wide. They were just had a great time, and hopefully that pays off for Breaking City.
Yeah, they went close last season. Yep. Hopefully they can go all the way back to the proper leagues.
Definitely.
This year.